If you dig, dig, dig with a shovel or a pick.
In a mine. In a mine, in a mine,
where a million diamonds shine. We dig, 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 dig from early on till night. We dig, 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 dig up everything in sight.
We dig up diamond by the score.
1,000 will be sometimes more,
but we don't know what we dig them for.
We dig, 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 dig.
Is that the way you went to work and went home from work every day? Yeah. Anyone remember when that movie, that animation came out, Walt Disney? Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs? 1937. Anyone see that in the theaters? That'd be... These dwarfs, they really had it going, though, don't you think? They liked what they did. They were singing along. They did all these great things. They were digging. Finding shiny things, diamonds. Yet even back then, they seemed to come against this wall, this struggle. Did you listen to the words? I know they're hard to hear, but let me just repeat the words here. It says, it ain't no trick to get rich quick. If you dig, dig, dig with a shovel or a pick, we dig up diamonds by the score, 1,000 rubies, sometimes more, but we don't know what we dig them for. We dig, 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 a dig, dig. Hi ho, hi ho, it's home from work we go. Wait, we work hard all day. It seems like every day, right? I mean, we sometimes even get good at what we do. And yet, we want it to mean something, right? Do we know what we're trying to get? Do we know what working is about? We want to know if it matters. We want to know if there's any value in all the hard work that we put in. I mean, think about it. A person will work around 90,000 hours in their lifetime. And that's just talking about the work while you're at work, right? There's all sorts of other types of work. I've talked to enough retired people around here that I've found out that work doesn't stop at retirement. Has anyone else found that to be true? A few of you, yeah. Some of you have told me that you're actually busier now than you were before you retired, which is interesting. So you're out there doing some things that maybe you really didn't even choose to do. You just had to get them done, right? That sounds like work, doesn't it? So that is why we're going to spend the next few weeks looking at work in the Bible. You know, the Bible has a few things to say about work. The truth is that most people, maybe not most, but many people, either hate their job or they are just kind of surviving because they have to survive, trying to get that paycheck, trying to... And then there's others who become workaholics because they find their identity in their occupation. How do we navigate work? How do we think through work? How do we not waste our work? And there's kids, there's teens that are just getting into chores and jobs, and they're trying to navigate that too. They want their work to matter. And who are they watching? They're watching us, trying to figure this out. Our worship of God does not stop on Sunday, but it really should continue into our workplace, shouldn't it? Monday through Friday, or whatever the schedule you work, it should fit in there somehow. So this morning, I'd like to get you thinking, just thinking about this topic. And a good place to start would be maybe thinking about how the contemporary culture thinks about work. And work certainly is a four-letter word. To most people in our culture, we're not supposed to like our work. It really keeps us from all that matters. Anything that we really want to do, yeah, that's work is just a distraction, isn't it? In fact, if you enjoy your work according to our culture, you can't even call it work, right? You have to call it something else. Think about it. Have you ever said the words, "I have to go to work"? Can you help but say it in a dejected way? I have to go to work. I mean, it's like you're saying, you go have fun, I'll go waste my life for the next 8 hours, right? And what if we enjoy our work? Well, then that's a worse situation. They call you different types of names, like workaholic. And we'll get into that later. It can be a problem, can't it? But can we enjoy our work and not fall into some of the troubles of workaholism, making it our identity? I mean, nowadays it seems like we're afraid to enjoy our work. We're supposed to bash on our work. I mean, when we get together with buddies, what do we talk about? Oh, you would not believe what I had to do at work, right? So think about a pie chart of your time, your day. I mean, you can pretty much split it up into thirds. You've got a third that you're going to be sleeping. You got another third that, as we've been talking about, you're working if you have a job. I mean, for better or worse, you're spending some time at work. And then we have this third area called everything else. What's in that category? Well, everything else, right. That's hanging out with family, it's hanging out with friends, it's doing the things we want to do, our hobbies, all those great things, our entertainment, going to church is in that category, spending money, I mean, everything else, right? List goes on and on. And actually, if you asked a person what their life was, they would describe everything else, right? Work's not part of life. Everything else is life. Now think about how much energy that we place on bringing God into this everything else category. Think about it. All of our conversations, we're talking about how to bring God into our families, into our marriages, into our parenting, and maybe even into our hobbies, and into our free time, into our finances. I mean, this is where almost all of our conversations are about God, right? In this one third, this everything else category. I mean, when we're talking about living our lives for God, when we say lives, we're thinking everything else, right? But that's only a third of our lives. Now, I haven't quite figured out a sermon series on how to glorify God while you sleep. Still working on that one. But there's a whole section of our lives, right? That's just sitting out there, this big chunk, where we just tend to, at times, just exist. We just don't talk about our work in terms of spiritual things very often. So turn with me to Genesis chapter 1 this morning. I'd really like to take a look. I mean, if you're going to look at what God says about work, it really probably is a good place to start at the very beginning. Just thinking through this. You know, in the book of Genesis, we see God creating the heavens and the earth, right? And really from the very first verses of the Bible, we see Him being a God who's not idle, is He? He's very active. He's not passive. He's very much involved. He's creating. He's building this creation. He's really hoping to have fellowship even with his creation. I mean, look at all he does. Beginning with verse 1, it says, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth." Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." There was light. God saw that the light was good and separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. You see a very involved God, right? In the creating of his world, his universe. And God said, "Let there be a vault between the waters to separate water from water." So God made the vault, separated the water under the vault from the water above it, and it was so. God called the vault sky. There was evening, there was morning, the second day. I mean, you see some designing, some building of the structure of the universe, trying to figure things out. That's work. And God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let dry ground appear." And it was so. God called the dry ground land, and gathered together the waters he called seas. God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants, trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds." And it was so. And that just didn't just happen, right? Someone was designing all of these plants. Someone was putting all these pieces together, all the variety that we see in creation. There's a lot going on. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. God saw that it was good. There was evening, there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the vault of the sky to separate the day from night, and let them serve as signs to mark sacred times and days and years. And let them be lights in the vault of the sky to give light on the earth." And it was so. God made two great lights. You notice that when he spoke it, and then he made it, it's kind of all the same work, but the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the vault of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night and separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the water teem with living creatures. Let birds fly above the earth across the vault of the sky." Again, the variety, the work that he would have put in designing all of these different systems, these creatures. So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living thing with which the water teems and that moves about in it according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them. He said, "Be fruitful and increase in number and fill the water in the seas, and let the birds increase on the earth." And there was evening, there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the land produce living creatures according to their kind." Livestock, the creatures that move along the ground. Wild animals, each according to its kind. And so it was. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. I don't know about you, but that's a pretty productive week. God putting all of this together, thinking through all the different systems, designing all of these different things. This isn't a God who's passive. This isn't a God who's distant. He's not just hanging out somewhere. God's working, isn't he? He's at work. He's right in the middle of the action. He's right in the muck of it all. He's designing, he's creating, he's doing all these things. I mean, he's creating light. He's putting together animals and plants and the sky. And I mean, God doesn't try avoiding work, does he? In fact, you could almost say that he enjoys it. He finds that it's good, right? And then finally we get to verse 26 when he creates human beings. Listen to this. "Then God said, 'Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals and over all the creatures that move along the ground.'" He's making mankind in his own image. But what kind of image are we created in? We're created after a God who's active, who's involved, who's creating, who's working, who's ruling. And he shares it with these human beings that he's created. Verse 27, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. I mean, do you see what's happening here? God created man in his own image, man and woman. And if God is a God who creates and works, and we're made in his image, then we are created with this work inside of us. He has some expectations for us to be working, right? Human beings are designed to create, to cultivate, to discover, to build. Humans were designed to work. Now, I think we get a little confused when you start looking at some of these words in here. Rule, subdue, did you catch those words? Genesis 1:28 is an example of that. Be fruitful and increase in number, God says. Fill the earth and subdue it. Now, I think it's important for us to point out there that this is God's creation, right? This is God's thing. This world, this universe, it's all God's. And he's not saying subdue it in a negative way, that we should mistreat it, that we should damage it in some way. It's really more of a subduing in an investing way, helping God's creation to actually be the best that it can be, to be stewards over God's creation, right? Now, this word steward is another word that we don't use very often. Dictionary.com defines steward as this, and I think this is really helpful. A person who manages another's property or financial affairs. One who administers anything as the agent of another or others. A person who has charge of the household of another, buying or obtaining food, directing the servants, etc. I mean, doesn't that make sense as we think about what our role is in this world, in this universe? It's not ours. It's not our creation. It's his. And we're just here to look after it, to invest in it. So God gives us, here in chapter 2 of Genesis, or chapter 1 of Genesis, actually, our original job description, to reflect his image into the world, to be his agents, to be his representatives. By doing what? By being cultivators, by being stewards, by being stewards of his magnificent creation. And that call to work is still on us today, isn't it? We still have that call in our lives. Now, I can hear some of you saying, Pastor Brian, you know, if that were my job description, to go and steward the earth and take care of all the beautiful creation that God has made and all those things, I'm great with that. But my job that I do, it's so far removed from actually investing in God's world. What about then? And we will get into the frustrations of work. We're going to get there. I hear you. We're just starting this conversation, but don't miss this passage. I think this is important. Notice when this call to work came. Think about this with me. When did it come? Where is it in the story of God? This was before the fall, wasn't it? The fall came in chapter 3. We're before that. It came while everything was right. It came while everything was good. Before sin came into the world. Why is that important? Because we often think that work is a curse, right? It's not part of the curse. It's part of our design. From the very beginning, work is supposed to be a reflection of worship to God. Stewarding God's world for the common good. I mean, think about the ramifications of that. If you just think through That work was actually part of our DNA even before the fall. What does that mean we're going to be doing in heaven? Have you thought about that? Are we going to be sitting in clouds, hanging out? Or are we going to be working? Is it enjoying work an okay thing? I hope so. I mean, think about this. Am I getting you thinking about work? I think this is important to think about. Maybe work is a more important piece of the puzzle than we usually give it credit for. Paul in Colossians chapter 3, he gives us a good application point for this first sermon in this series. While writing to the church in Colossae, verse 17, he says, "And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father." Now, what third of our lives do you think that Paul's referring to here? Think he's just talking about the everything else, or do you think that he's talking about it all? I mean, he's thrown a pretty wide net out there, isn't he? Whatever you do, not when you're off work and you actually have free time, go and do this, right? It's whatever you do, whether word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Whatever we do. And I think that might include our work. You think? A little later in the chapter, in verse 23, Paul says, "Whatever you do, work at it." Uh-oh, use the W word. "Work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward." You get a reward for your work? Is the Lord Christ you are serving? I mean, he even uses the word work right in the passage. What is he saying? Well, I think Paul is pointing out to us that if we have asked Jesus into our lives to be our Lord, to be our Savior, to be our King, then you know what? Everything changes. Even our work changes. Because we no longer work for us, we work for Him. The Lord becomes our focus even in the menial tasks of life. Every task becomes an opportunity to worship. Think about that. To reflect Jesus to our world. It's the Lord Jesus Christ that you are serving. I mean, just soak into that for a moment. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters. Do you know who Paul is referring to in this passage? You know who he's talking to? He's talking to slaves, real ones. Not our version. I mean, there's times when we're at work and we're thinking, well, they're slave drivers. They're not really slave drivers. These are the real ones. These are slaves. Do you ever feel like you're a slave at work? Like no one cares about you, no one cares what you're doing? Well, there is someone who does care. There's someone who is interested in what you're doing, no matter what it is. Our work can be an opportunity to work for God, to worship God. Our worship of God does not stop on Sunday, does it? Doesn't stop with everything else in our lives. But truly, we have an opportunity to continue our worship throughout the week, even into our work. So as we close this morning, I don't know where you are with the whole work conversation. I know some of you are done with work. You don't want to work anymore. You're retired, but you're still working. We all have tasks to do in our lives that we don't want to do. We didn't choose to do them. Maybe you're struggling at your job. Maybe you have a job that you just don't like. Be encouraged that God sees you there. Be encouraged that God is interested in what you're doing. He knows your struggles. Maybe this is an opportunity to begin a conversation with God about work. And really your desire, even in these seemingly meaningless tasks, to worship Him through your work. Well, maybe you're in a difficult situation. Maybe it's not your job. Maybe it's just hard things that you're going through in life. And those oftentimes what I call real life, right? You're needing to do some things with your family or some area of your life that's just hard right now. And so you're left to do things that you would never choose to do on your own. And that to me sounds like work. So can you trust that God is with you even in those hard moments, those hard choices, even in your hard situation? Will you offer even that kind of work up to God as worship to do in His name? Maybe you like work. Maybe you love your job, and you're just not sure if you're supposed to feel guilty about that or ashamed about that. I'm not sure why I like my job and nobody else likes my job. I mean, a little confused about that. Be assured that God has designed you for work. It's okay to love your job, to be productive, to do things that maybe you wouldn't choose to do on your own. But maybe your moment is to choose not to do it for just your own enjoyment, but to also do it as worship to God in the name of the Lord, being thankful to God the Father. Not just something that you enjoy doing, but something that you can do as worship, as if working for the Lord. You know what I mean? Let's give thanks to Him. No, this is work is always a fun topic to work through. But it's such a big piece of our lives, isn't it? What do we do with work? How do we not waste our work? Pray with me. Lord God, I am so thankful, Lord, for your word. So thankful that your word applies to our lives. There's just not a topic that we can't find in Scripture that helps us to deal with the things that we deal with in life. Lord God, I am so thankful that you thought of us so highly as you created your amazing universe, Lord. That you actually expect us to work alongside with you. What a great honor to be at work on the things that you are interested in, Lord. Lord God, there are times when we just don't feel like work is something that we like to do. Maybe we're in a job that we're just struggling with. We don't see how there's any meaning in it, Lord. Would you encourage us in that, Lord? Help us to see that even if we're in just a hard time in life, Lord, that we truly know that you are with us, that you care about us, that you're interested in the work that we do, and that we can truly do work for you. Maybe we're in a situation where we just don't like our boss. It's not very nice. Lord, can you help us to just focus on you? You are the one that we work for. We give thanks to you for the opportunities that we have to serve. Lord God, as we enter into this series, would you just help us to start thinking through how our work affects our worship, how work could be worship? It's not a concept that we talk about a lot, Lord. Help us to understand your ways, your thoughts. Help us to trust you, even in the times we're working. And we will give you all the praise. Give you all the thanks. So thankful that you are part of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. You are sent.